Hello Blender aficionados, and welcome back to the fifth tutorial I have ever created. At this point I think that at least I am a little bit better speaking on the microphone, or at least I am a little bit clearer. This is the second part of the tutorial on how to create a realistic box for mockups, for I don't know, 3D creation of elements to visualize your products. Can be used for any kind of feature. The good thing of this project is that you can completely customize your product. My name is Daniele and I am a 3D artist. I would like to start showing you how I set up the texture of my file. As you can see, I created the box and I have used that in the previous tutorial to cut the box, to create my box. But I'm gonna use the same image as a guide for the texture or the textures, because I would like to create an additional tutorial with a little bit more sparkling animations and a little bit of more node editor. Anyway, I wanted to create different textures that can be replaced on the original model. I really speed up the animation because this process can take a while. It took around half an hour to me. We have our old model. As you can see, I have used different collections so I can arrange them, and I also exported my brand logo in SVG in a way that I can extrude it in Blender. So you just need to go into File, Import, and you select SVG, and you can import your logo. And if you go on the right, you can give your logo a little bit of thickness. When you give thickness, you are not creating a mesh, you are still using a path. So you can still adjust your path if you need. For example, as you can see, there are a little bit of problems in my path. There are different ways to sort them out, but in this very case, all I had to do is adjusting the path as if you would do in any vector graphic software. I created my logo in Affinity Designer, and you can export in SVG from any vector graphic program. What I did then is turning my logo into a mesh. You can go into Object, Convert to Mesh, and after that I selected all the faces of my mesh and I UV unwrapped from the top, unwrapped from view. So basically I placed my mesh on the logo, and I used the same UV map of the texture. So what I did, I placed on the top of my texture, and in this way the whole logo took the color of the texture. The texture that I used to create the logo anyway, because I exported it directly from that. I did the same for the logo of YouTube, but in this case I didn't really need to UV unwrap the logo because YouTube is a plain color. I mean, the logo type, the written part of the logo is just white. The symbol of YouTube is red. All I had to do was finding the actual color. If you go online on the resources of YouTube website, you can find everything. You can actually find the vector file of the logo with the brand guidelines on how to use it. In any case, when I convert my brands into meshes. In this very case, you don't really need to convert into a mesh because you don't need to apply a texture to it, you just need to apply a color. But when you convert into a mesh, you will notice that the faces are not completely well aligned, but you don't really need to worry because you can smooth the object directly in the panel that allows you to extrude it. Of course, you have a little bit less flexibility. I can show you in the future how to make sure that when you convert an object into a mesh, when you convert a path into a mesh, the mesh is properly set up. I decided then to change a little bit the floor. I would like to create a kind of a pillar holding my box, and I simply sculpt the pillar. What I did, I added two loop cuts. I made sure that the top of the pillar as well has a proper geometry. It's better to have quads, so polygons with four faces, rather than n-gons, so polygons with up to infinite faces, because in this way you can apply effect and you don't have weird artifacts on your models like I did here, because I probably touched something and I disconnected a vertex, so it took me a while to figure out why this happened. But in any case, you can always rebuild your mesh if it doesn't work properly. Always try to work simple and then add details later. This will save you a lot of time. What I want to do is having the top part made of wood and the bottom part made of concrete. So the wood will be set up as axis, and because of this I need to UV unwrap the object as well. What I did is adding loop cuts and marking the edges of my object. You can select an edge, press Ctrl E, and then mark scene, and then mark the edge that you would like to be cut in the UV map. Also, when I added that, I noticed that a part of my UV is not working. I mean, it has a hole, because even if a vertex looked exactly in the same position, was not connected to the other, so I just had to connect the vertices. I would like to create a tutorial about all those small tricks, because they can be really useful to know, like connecting vertices and shortcuts. Probably I will create a tutorial about shortcuts. Once you create the material, you need to connect different parts of it. On HDR Heaven, you can download a lot of maps, and those maps can be useful for you because you can find maps like diffuse, like roughness, like normal. Diffuse basically is the color, roughness is how this color reflects the light, and normal gives an idea of how high the surface should be. Basically, you can create a surface that looks 3D even if it's not. You can create veins in the wood and I don't know how small indents into the concrete and so on. What I did next was adding an HDR map. This doesn't really need a lot of explanations. I did that in the previous video, in the video number 2, where I explained this technique. What I did was adding a white background but lit with an HDR image. The cool thing of EEVEE and Blender 2.83, yes, I'm using the 83, is the fact that you can render in real time. So you can basically model while you are seeing a very close idea of the final scene of what you're gonna render. After that, all I had to do was adding the cameras. The cameras are object, so you add them pressing Shift A, you add your cameras, and you animate selecting the proper position on the timeline, placing the camera in the position in the space where you want to the camera to move, and pressing I. When you press I, you animate a parameter. So if you have the camera selected in the 3D view and you press I, you will see that it appears a menu that allows you to select rotation, position, scale, anything. And one of the problems that I met animating the camera around the object is that it doesn't focus on the object, because of course the rotation is not around a pivot point, that's the object. So all I had to do was adding a constraint to the camera that forces the camera to target a null object that I placed at the center. You can actually use your own box if you want, but seeing that I placed the pivot point of the box on the bottom, I thought it was better to use the null object. You can share the null object with different cameras. Usually when I animate, I place all the cameras and I operate all the cuts at once. So there is a very nice technique to change camera in Blender. All you have to do in the timeline is set a marker pressing M on the timeline, then select the camera you want to switch to, and going on the marker and press Ctrl B. Pressing Ctrl B, you attach the camera to that marker. So when the cursor passes the marker, the camera is switched. And you do that for all the cameras. So I did at the beginning with the first camera, then second camera, then third camera, and so on. When I render my videos, I usually use OpenEXR as a format. It is because the colors are a lot better, and you can import that in any kind of software. Even the thumbnail that I use on YouTube is one of the frames that I exported from my video in OpenEXR. I think that for now it is everything. I mean, this can leave a lot of questions, I understand. And feel free to write on the comments. I will try to answer any kind of question. I will see you next week with a new advanced version of this tutorial, where I will try to explain how to set up animated colors on the box. For now, I wish you a great week. And see you soon.